I mean, Councilmember Brady.
Okay, thank you. All right, we'll move to public comment period. And this is the time for members of the public who wish to be heard on matters that do not appear on the agenda. And pursuant to City Council Resolution 2011-22, a City Council policy is to limit each speaker to 3 minutes, and such time allotment or portion thereof shall not be transferred to other speakers. The public will be allowed to speak concurrently with the calling of an agenda item following the staff presentation of that item. Pursuant to the Brown Act, the City Council cannot take action on any item that does not appear on the agenda. So I'd like to address the council. Go ahead and step forward.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, ladies and gentlemen of the council. Yes, I am a board member of HSAA, Homeless Students Advocacy Alliance. The seating is for 300. Thank you for announcing that. I am here tonight to speak on a very sensitive subject. It is on the criminalization of homelessness and what this city has been doing and what hasn't been doing. We have been before this council. I've been here since November of 2017. We've asked for agendized items for homelessness to be put on the agenda. To no avail, there has not been. And I have been doing some records searches in regards to specific all tickets and citations under the arrest and arrest for panhandling, aggressive solicitation, force set forth in the City of Eureka Municipal Code as of January 1st, 2016, April through April 30th of 2017, 78 cases have been filed. I would like to also remind you, and I will give you this as a document, challenges, bans, restrictions of panhandling cases in from 2013 through 2015. First Circuit, Fourth Circuit, Sixth, Seventh Circuit, Tenth Circuit, and Eleventh Circuit deems it unconstitutional. I have also made a records request act as of December 4th, 2017. As of January 1, 2016 through April 30th of 2017, 976 arrests, cases have been cited to homeless people for camping in public. I would like to refer to a document called California New Vagrancy Laws, the Growing Encampment Enforcement of Anti-Homeless Laws in the Golden State. This was released February 2015 from Berkeley Law School. And the statement of interest that was given by the United States Department of Justice. I have filed this with the civil grand jury, hand-delivered this to the grand jury foreman as of 2 days ago. I made a presentation to the Human Rights Commission, and my intention is to ask this council to immediately put this upon an agendized item and ask for a willful moratorium on the six ordinances that you have that criminalizes homelessness. I will be, at this point, making a declaration to the complaint about law enforcement officers and law enforcement agencies with the California Department of Justice, and I will leave that document with you also. And I encourage you to meet with me with the press after this forum. Thank you so much for your time, your concern, and your consideration on this matter. And if there's any questions, I'll be glad to address those. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Good evening, City Council, Mayor, City Manager. My name is John Shelter, New Directions Program. And a lot of people thought I'd be upset that you guys invited the Downtown Streets team into town. But instead, I'm actually kind of excited because it shows 7 years ago, we had Back to Basics at the North Coast Resource Center in Arcata. We ran that program for $225,000 a year, providing food boxes for the low-income families, 60 showers, hot meals for anywhere from 150 to 200 people. The big thing is that we've already done that and been there. I know them just as well, their program, because when we shut our doors at North Coast Resource Center, they had just started the Coyote Creek project. If we look at their budget and all their other member paperwork that they've shared out, the big difference between New Directions and the Downtown Streets team is that the city supported them, the county supported them, recreation supported them, public works supported them. Homelessness affects each and every one of our departments in all of our cities. I think there are some jobs out there that maybe the homeless can do, are willing to do, and can thrive at. We need to really start looking at self-supporting, not bringing another nonprofit in, but look at what we can get for a return on our dollar. New Directions has never asked for a penny. All we ask for is work. We work hard, we pay our homeless, they move from their tents and move forward in their lives. This isn't about New Directions, this is about making the right decisions. Why would we want to bring in somebody from Santa Cruz or wherever they come from originally to teach our homeless what to do when we already have a viable program here that's already experienced and grown out of their stage into the self-supporting stage? Isn't that what we want in our communities? We want the homeless to work their way back, and they are willing to if we give them the opportunities. Unfortunately, New Directions is just a small little business, because in 2011, our board decided that employing the homeless was too risky, too much of a liability. That's not true. 7 years later, we have not had a workman's comp claim or unemployment claim. Now, maybe some could, but they never did because they thrived, they moved back with family members, they moved on. Our program doesn't work for everybody, just like their program probably doesn't work for everybody. But it's sure a better start, guys. I thank you so much. And you guys are a lot smarter than I am. So let's put our heads together and figure out why we're not involved. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. My name is Sean Swanson. I'm the founder of River Life Foundation from Fortuna. I've worked with John Shelter for the last, I would say, just about 6 years. For about a year, I worked for John, heading up his crews when we did the Spartana on the safety corridor. The only reason why I ended up leaving John is because the government shutdown and the funding for that program ended up ending. During that time, we had helped several people get out of whether they were living in motels, living in the brush. John gave them a chance, gave them a hand up, not a hand out, and helped to change many lives. I personally now work for a construction company in Fortuna, and then I also run River Life. River Life Foundation uses John Shelter's guys. They come down, they volunteer for when we do our river bar cleanups. They have also been paid to do river bar cleanups when we can afford to do it. They've also come to my personal residence and mowed my hill, and very respectful, do awesome jobs. These guys that he gets have been downtrodden. I've been homeless myself, so I know what it's like to be totally lost with nothing. John helps to provide hope, just as River Life Foundation provides hope. River Life Foundation has gotten 131 people out of the area, reunited with family or onto jobs. In the Fortuna area, we've cleaned up 276,000 pounds of trash. That's because of awesome volunteers that help get awesome stuff done. John Shelter and New Directions is a positive force in Eureka and the community of Humboldt. Thank you very much.
Evening, my name is Jimmy Work. Homelessness, trims ends, up for the term unsheltered American myself. You know, the Constitution is a pretty simple document. You know, you can't just keep taking our stuff every week. You can't just, you hunt us down the Hickshaw Trail in this gator they have. I see grown men and women sitting there like feral animals, their ears perk up at the sound of a motor, they run. Why? We didn't do anything wrong. We're not trespassing. You took it. You took our stuff from us. What do you think we're going to do, let our families go without? No, we're going to go get more however we can. We're not the cause of the crime. You are. You make policy. Policy's enforced. And these jackbooted thugs you have running around doing this, insulting us personally, making it a personal issue, and you grant them power of personal persuasion instead of political influence or personal influence instead of professional power. No one's stupid. No one knows. Everyone knows what that means. I mean, what have we done so wrong to you? I'm a 17-year combat veteran in the United States Army. This is my home. Who gave you the right to wake up one day and tell me I'm not welcome? Who gave you the authority to adopt a self-deportation policy? What gave you the right? I gave you that right, not to abuse it. That's all you've done. You've taken my wife from me. She was going to die outside. She was taken from me. We didn't do anything wrong. She was taken by you. And then you get take high umbrage when people get offended. But every document that comes out of this building that affects my life and makes it worse has your signature on it. And you sit there and clear consciences, I don't see how you do it. Every citizen shall be secure in their persons, their dwellings, their papers, and their effects. You should not be infringed upon without substantial due process. Now shall agents be sent forth. Where are the warrants? Where are the affidavits? Where's the due process? If you're going to eradicate me, do it openly, publicly. Where's the accountability? I have no quarrel with you. I didn't start anything with you. But you've taken everything from me, and you still take. You know, I'm going to die out here. I'm going to die out here alone. I wonder how long my body's going to be bloated and eaten by animals until I'm found. Then will they even be able to identify me? You know, I'm going to get a brick over my head somewhere with John Doe number 84 on it. And people want to thank me for my service, you should apologize. You guys need to make things right. You're doing it wrong, and you know it. Over half the nation is united against this type of action. I mean, I make a lot of people angry, and I'm pretty abrasive. But come on, you guys are overachievers. Over half the United States is upset with these policies, and you can't see that as wrong? I mean, come on. Stand up and be counted. Be accountable. Do something. Thank you.
Mayor Yeager, councillors and city manager. My name's Donna Wright and I'm the executive director at the Eureka Chamber of Commerce. I'd like to endorse the work of New Directions and under the leadership of John Shelter. 6 months ago, the Chamber had a large financial commitment to a company for the well-being of our staff and visitors, not including cleanup. After meeting with John and setting clear needs, guidelines and boundaries to assist with the homeless problem we were experiencing, almost immediately, we found New Direction dramatically reduced people camping, loitering, and while we've had the occasional problems and we've had the support of the police, we have dramatically reduced our costs. Additionally, they do the cleanup for us as well. They reduce the costs and we now work in a safe, clean environment. So I'd just like to endorse them.
Thank you, Donna.
Hello, Janelle Lager. I'm from Fortuna. I also, again, want to talk to you about the homeless issue, homelessness. The board has, as I have said before, a new committee, the Trust Fund and Homelessness Solutions Committee, and I have applied for that. And I am again asking for your support for that, for me to be on that committee. I also noticed on the consent calendar is the the minutes from your strategic planning sessions, the 2 days that you met to do strategic planning. And the first day that I was there, there was a lot of people, of council members voicing concern about homeless issues and at the opioid town hall took exception to me saying that you hadn't been talking about homelessness. But when you talk about housing, that is a solution to homelessness, but that's a long-term solution and something needs to be done now. People are out there, people are down. So when I applied for the committee, I was very open with them and said that I want to work on a camp. And that was a brave thing to do because half the nation is not with me on this. And unlike what Mr. Work said, it is not a popular position to be in to advocate for a camp. But that is not what I want, but that is what is needed right now. There are people out subject to the laws that the we're talked to you about, and they need a legal place to be. So again, I'm asking you to support my appointment to that commission or that committee. And I will resend it to you. I heard that they're not going to be making the appointments until next month. So you have some time. Thank you.
All right.
Good evening. Thank you for letting me come before you. My name's Harry Wilcox. I live on N Street here in Eureka. I love this city. I'm proud of the city. I'm a transplant from New York City. I'm here again to talk about the ordinance that we passed here a little while ago. And the results of it is, if you look on the website for Hatcher, they printed up what I can only call just cook numbers. I mean, they won't even try to explain their numbers to you. You call them, you contact them. They can't tell you where they got those numbers from. I believe that they're including numbers from people like myself who volunteer, without that meaning to, pick up needles and dispose of them or give them to them. Some diabetic needles, I believe, are thrown in there. But there's no way they're doing anything. I live right between Ross Park and Cooper's Gulch. My backyard is Cooper's Gulch. I never see anybody down there as a group or otherwise identifying themselves as being from Hatcher, collecting needles. And I mean, I can walk right along the path and pick them up. My dog stepped on one. Thank God he didn't get anything. But I'm here again to say we have got to put some teeth in that measure. We've got to revisit it, put some teeth in it, and make these people, yes, I know there's more than this subject that Hatcher handles, but I go to NA meetings. I've talked to people. They have never tried to get those people who, when they were active, to go into rehab or any other program. It's here, here's your needles, we're busy. And that's a fact. That's no bull crap. What you see online, you go to their site, that recent report, I think they should have come before the council and given that report, not just release it on some website, hoping no one would see it and blow it under the table. And I think that's part of what we need to do, is require them to come before this council and account for the needles that they give out, the needles they take in, how they're, break it down for us. You know, I volunteer to pick up needles all the time. Yeah, volunteering for Eureka is fine, but if I got to spend all my time picking up needles to keep kids safe, I ain't got time to go out and do all this beautification stuff. I'm doing my share by walking the streets and picking up the needles and chasing the bums out of the park. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to address the council on non-agenda item?
Evening, Council, Mayor. Bob Toole. I want to thank Allison or Austin for bringing up this climate change. We're in trouble if it actually happens. And Natalie for bringing up your subject too. But what I'd like to see is the council get back to council reports, your committee reports. I haven't heard any of you give a committee report that you're on for I don't know how long. And I'd like to see you get back to that. Put this other stuff on an agenda item so that everybody has a chance to see it, go over it, and go from there. But stick to your council reports, and I think it would be a lot better. And I'm glad he brought up the needle exchange again. Again, I direct your attention to that handout I give you. The work order, work done on that ordinance, and we do need some strict teeth in there. I looked at that report from Hatcher online, and a lot of other people have done it. The numbers just don't add up, and something has to be done. Yesterday, I walked the railroad track between T Street and Blue Ox. I picked up 5 bags of those Easy Touch syringe bags that have been discarded. Luckily, I didn't find any needles. I was shocked. But I did find one needle down by the Eureka Boiler Works, and the owner there, Dale Holger, brought it to my attention, and I put my gloves on and got my Sharps container and picked it up. But something has to be done with this needle exchange. Get some teeth in that ordinance and start enforcing it.
Does anyone else want to address the council at this time?
Y'all can do better. I know it was a rush to get it off of your agenda. It was obvious from the fact that some wanted to table it and others wanted it pushed through. It was obvious from the fact that you did it without all of the facts in place. You didn't have the answer to the question, where does the control of the needle exchange reside? Matt Cain from the Office of AIDS will do everything he can to avoid answering that question. He will tell you, I can't answer that. It's for lawyers to tell you. But the dots are there to connect. The state has authorized needle exchanges before, the most prominent example being Orange County. Orange County was voted out of existence by their local board. Control of needle exchanges resides at the local level. So you needn't fear that. And if you had tabled it, you would have known. I do ask that you revisit the pharmacy sales question. I know that you can't stop pharmacy sales, but it would be nice to have a number. It would be a simple matter of asking the pharmacies to establish a separate UPC code. They can track how many they're selling that way, and we'd have a number, and we'd have a way of knowing what are we picking up. Are we picking up Hatcher needles, or are these pharmacy needles? And if there's more pharmacy needles out there than we guessed, we need to start addressing the people buying there and getting them to Hatcher, or the county, or somebody that can start getting them on a path to wellness. You can do better. Please do.
Anyone else want to address the council on a non-agenda item? Okay, seeing no one, we'll close the comment period and move to... Okay, go ahead.
Hi, I didn't expect to speak, but hearing this, what's been talked about, I think that if there's programs like New Directions, just think of the number of needles there'd be without them. I don't think that they're spending their time, you know, lollygagging around. They're in their work for a reason. It's not easy work. So without that, there'd be even more needles, and really a tiny house village or three, maybe one just specifically for people needing to recoup from mental health issues, would go a long way to solve a lot of these issues, because the only people suffering more than those picking up needles are those shoving them into their veins to try to mitigate the pain of running from police, mandatory medications, very little psychological support, and what support there is doesn't do much good when people are hiding in the bushes or in their vehicles. And as far as, it's great there's programs like New Directions, but when you think about hand up versus hand out, where did your bootstraps come from? What got you to where you are today? Because I think everyone who's anywhere has gotten some handouts. And a lot of the people who are homeless have already cleaned homes and done landscaping and cleaned up city streets and done all sorts of things. And one too many traumas, one too many things maybe you can't even imagine. A lot of the people that are homeless are from the foster system. They have alumni back from the day when there wasn't as many programs as there are now. There are still not enough for the orphans, which are euphemistically called foster children, except for no disrespect to the parents who still want and should be having their children in their custody. So really mental health hasn't been discussed here, and the terror of being homeless and hiding and feeling like a criminal when all you need is a place to rest and recoup and heal, that just isn't acceptable, and I think it's affecting all of our health. And so I hope something's collectively done about it, and the tiny house village seems like a great proven thing done elsewhere, and maybe more than one. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name's Mike Toglia. I'm a resident in Arcata. I wanted to bring up an issue that is a public health issue involving the Medi-Cal partnership and Dentical situation here in Humboldt County, where there's really only one facility in this area who has not accepted any adult patients in somewhere around 10 years. And that is to say that they are not a designated pediatric facility, and they do have existing adult patients, but they will not allow any new adult patient over the age of 19. But if you're under the age of 19, they'll accept you at any time. As far as I'm concerned, that is discrimination based upon age. They can accept new patients if you're under, under 18, so they have the ability to take in new people, and they're not a pediatric facility, so they do have adult existing patients, but they won't accept anybody over the age of 19, and that's been like that for somewhere upwards of 10 years. I spoke to a local news agency this afternoon. I also spoke to a representative from the administrative office of the Open Door Center, and they acknowledge that this is a serious problem. But a serious problem that hasn't been addressed at all in upwards of a decade, that affects, you know, I don't know exactly how many people, but everybody that are, you know, these are low-income people that are on Medi-Cal or under the Dentical beneficiary program that are not getting adequate medical care. And I think that it's something that needs to be addressed on a more prominent level. And so I'm presenting it here tonight so that you guys are aware of this existing problem, and that hopefully we can find a solution that is suitable for the community, because right now, people, in order to get any kind of care, you have to travel outside of the area. In fact, that you have to go to Redway or Hoopa, and Redway doesn't accept any new patients either, and I'm not even sure about Hoopa, but it's probably the same thing. So. And just in closing, Mr. Allison, I'd like to speak with you after to speak with your energy idea. Okay.
Thank you. Good evening. It's nice to see you. It's been a long time since I've been here. May 2nd will be 2 years since Palco Marsh has pushed, you've pushed everybody to the streets. And I've been watching and listening, and I hear that we have a crisis. There. In every way in this city, and I've been waiting for 2 years, we've been waiting. And the thought of 900 tickets, what concerns me on that is that what we're doing to the people in breaking them down with that criminalization, but also the money that you're spending. It's got to be in the millions of dollars to do this, and it's not working. And I think that if you talk to anybody that lives here or drives through here or comes to the music festivals, will tell you it's not working, because what we have done is you have taken them from one area and put them in the streets, and you've put them on everybody's doorsteps. And I know, because my children live here and I deal with them every day. But what we need is a place for them to go. So the money that we spent in law enforcement, which has to be in the millions in the last 2 years, I'd like to look at that. We should look at those figures, and maybe it would be more convincing. But we could use that money to put them in a place where they're safe. I watched yesterday the police harass people for sitting, laying down, and I get it. We don't want them laying down on our streets and doing all those things, but we have to give them a place to do that. So thank you. It's good to see you. It's nice to see you, Mayor, and I wish you well. Thank you.
All right.
Hello. I haven't been here for a while because I was having some trouble with my foot, so it's pretty interesting to come back. And what I want to say is, if it's anybody's fault, because we're all blaming, it's mine. Because I can think of a million things I could or should be doing. But I think the real key is not about blame, it's about taking responsibility, shared responsibility. And I'm thrilled to hear about the summit. Lynette Mullen made a terrific presentation at the Board of Supervisors. But this is what has concerned me from the beginning, and I think we need to look at it, and I hope that people watching will consider this. that the Housing First strategy, the focus strategy, with good intentions, with love and hope in your heart, sets out policies which have ended up leading to where we're now criminalizing, demonizing, and letting people out on the street with no hope. And what it says is that she actually doesn't even have a policy for emergency care, but she says she discourages it and said that there should not no offering services that creating legalized, expanding emergency shelter capacity. She talks against that, but she also talks against evicting people, which we did. And then later at January 26th, and I keep bringing this up because I think it's so important, she actually said, when she was asked whether you should have an emergency response, she said in a flippant manner, you can look at it, it's January 26th, because on the one hand, people die outside, and that happens all the time. Homeless people die outside, and they die for lots of reasons. But if they weren't outside, in many cases, they wouldn't have died, right? I have a transcript of that presentation. It is a powerful one that she made to the board. Lots of great ideas that I think we should go back and look at and institute, and adopt. And I'm thrilled about the summit. But the thing is, why would we even think it's okay to arrest people outside? Because we think they've made some kind of choice, that they're criminals, that they're less than human. And if you watch the January 9th, 2018 presentation, heroically, the county staff, Connie Beck, said that they can only help the people that they're mandated to help. And Sally Hewitt was also, and I'll give her a title because I'm always forgetting titles, but bear with me here. But she talked about, she was a program manager with the Department of Health and Human Services. She said that if people don't have money for rent, they can't help them. So, and if you call the Eureka Rescue Mission, I think it's a terrific organization. I celebrate everybody who helps people who need help. But we're leaving people outside. And what I'm asking for is, as a community, as a council, we start to care about it instead of having a policy of disappearing people, arresting them, demonizing them. And one woman that I talked to on the board said she often thinks about killing herself. And she's a vibrant, vital, interesting person. And this is what's happening. People are losing faith and hope. They're being shunned. They're being chased around by the police. They're being arrested and cited. And they're made to feel like they're subhuman. And nothing good comes of that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for not turning off my mic.
All right, does anyone else want to address the council on a non-agenda item? Okay, seeing no one, we close the public comment period and move to public hearings. Wendy?